Chapter 14, Outsmarting a Liar. The racket caused by the falling furniture sent Wilcox and Fortin running back to the basement. The animal trainer, instead of asking if Nancy had been hurt, said to her angrily, "What were you trying to do? You have no right touching anything around here. You were snooping, that's what. Talk!" Wilcox said icily, "I'm sure she meant no harm. Are you hurt?" By this time, Nancy had picked herself up, and though her clothes were dusty from the furniture, she had not been injured. "I'm sorry, Mr. Fortin," she said. "I used to have a desk very much like this one. When I touched it, the whole pile came tumbling down." Fortin's face was grim. Nancy thought he was going to say he did not believe a word of her story. Quickly, she asked, "Is this desk for sale?"
"No!"
The animal trainer almost shouted at her. "And I'd appreciate your leaving. I have work to do." Mr. Wilcox spoke up. "We'll go at once, and I'll give the health service an excellent report about your animal operation here." While Nancy brushed dust from her clothes, she took in every detail of the wall behind the pile of furniture. She had spotted a steel door. Evidently, Longman had rushed downstairs to try hiding it with the pile of furniture. Something secret must be inside. Nancy had also noticed heavy cables in the basement. One of them ran through the wall next to the half-hidden door. Fortin said sarcastically, "Listen, miss, you're delaying my work. Please go at once." "Oh, I'm sorry," Nancy apologized and scooted up the stairway. She was puzzled by what she had seen. The young detective had a strong hunch that something besides the training of wild animals for a circus was going on at the moss-covered mansion. Mr. Wilcox and his secretary left the house and rode off. Nancy told him what she had seen in the cellar. "Why do you think Fortin was trying to conceal that door?" Wilcox smiled. "I'm no detective, but I suspect he had something hidden behind it. Since I insisted upon seeing everything, he was probably afraid I might want to look in there. I'm sure no wild animal was inside. Otherwise, it would have picked up our scent and made some kind of noise." Nancy said no more, and in a short time she and the health inspector reached the Billington house. She thanked him for his help and jumped out of the car. Bess and George met her at the front door. "Thank goodness you're here in one piece," said Bess. George asked, "Did you learn anything exciting?" Nancy related her experience to the girls, Mrs. Billington and Hannah Gruen. All of them tried guessing what might be beyond the steel door where the furniture had been piled up. "Even though Mr. Wilcox doesn't think so," Bess put in, "I'll bet there's some kind of an animal behind that door." "You could be right," Mrs. Billington said, frowning. George had a different theory. "I'm sure Fortin only keeps those wild animals to scare people away and isn't training those beasts to perform. There's some other reason he and Longman are living at the moss-covered mansion."
"Like what?" Bess asked.
"There could be all kinds of secret rooms," her cousin replied. Nancy was intrigued by this idea. "They might even be storing explosives." Bess stared at her friend.
"Are you hinting that Mr. Fortin might have been responsible for the explosive oranges that were shipped into the space center?"
George answered, "I wouldn't put it past him." Mrs. Billington looked worried.
"If you're right and anything should go wrong, the whole of Merritt Island could be blown up."
Nancy turned to Hannah. "You haven't said a word. What do you think?" Looking worried, the housekeeper replied that their suspicions about the moss-covered mansion should be reported to the FBI. Nancy pointed out, "But it's mostly speculation. We haven't any constructive evidence."
She also reminded the others that the FBI had a good lead about the person responsible for stealing the oranges and delivering them to the Space Center. He was Max Ivinson. The man had disappeared and not been found yet. When Mr. Drew and Mr. Billington came in, the results of Nancy's visit to the moss-covered mansion were reported to them. The men were as interested in the story as the others had been. They had no solutions to offer. Mr. Drew said that he had obtained a postponement of Mr. Billington's trial. "I have some other news, too," he added. "I found out there's no Tripp Brothers Circus listed. Of course, that doesn't mean there isn't one. It may be too small and unimportant to be in the police information files."
"I'm sure," Nancy said, "that the whole thing is a cover-up for something sinister."
Bess sighed and changed the subject.
"While you were out, Nancy, we had a call from Mrs. Nickerson. Ned and Dave and Bert will be down tomorrow."
Nancy's face broke into a smile. How glad she would be to see Ned! "And it will be great to have him help on the mystery," she thought.
Bess told Nancy that she and George had been busy laundering the girls' clothes, including Nancy's.
"So we're all ready for the Nickersons' house party," she told her.
"You were sweet to do that," said Nancy.
"Thanks."
She learned that Tina and Anton had the day off, so all the work had fallen on the others.
"Would you mind doing the marketing?" Mrs. Billington asked Nancy. "We need a number of things. Perhaps you three girls could go and divide the shopping list."
"I'd like to," Nancy replied. "By the way, do you have the Webster's new address?"
"No, I'm sorry, I don't."
Nancy decided to stop at the post office on the chance she could get it. She said, "Mrs. Billington, I don't trust Mr. Scarlett, and I'd like to check his story with the owner." The girls drove to town, and each went in a different direction to buy meat, vegetables, fruits, paper napkins, and various other items. As soon as Nancy finished her shopping, she walked to the post office. There she asked if she might have Mr. Webster's other address, and told why she wanted it. The postal clerk smiled, but said he was not allowed to give out such information.
"If you wish to write a letter and mail it, I'll be glad to forward it."
"I'll think about that," Nancy replied, and turned away. A woman who stood nearby had heard the girl's request. Now she came up to her and said, "I'm a friend of Mr. and Mrs. Webster. I know their city address. Would you mind telling me in more detail why you want it?" Nancy explained the complication about the couple's Merritt Island home and that she wanted to speak directly to Mr. Webster about its being taken off the market. The woman smiled. She took an address book from her handbag and flipped the pages to W. Then she wrote down the address of her friends, the Websters, and handed it to Nancy.
"Thank you very much," Nancy said. "As soon as I get home, I'll phone them."
As the young detective was about to leave the post office, she saw something that made her step back quickly. Walking along the street and carrying on an animated conversation were Mr. Scarlett and Mr. Fortin. "They are friends," she decided. "I wish I could hear what they're talking about." This was not feasible, because Scarlett would identify her and tell Fortin. Perhaps Fortin had already described her to Scarlett, and he in turn had told her who she was. Nancy waited until the men were out of sight, then went to the Billingtons' car where the girls had arranged to meet. When Bess and George heard about the men, they agreed with Nancy that no doubt she had been identified.
"This means more trouble," Bess prophesied.
As soon as Nancy reached home, she telephoned Mr. Webster long distance. He answered immediately. Nancy introduced herself and told why she was calling.
"I'm certainly glad you got in touch with me," Mr. Webster said.
"I can't understand Mr. Scarlett's actions. He has had no instructions from me to take my Merritt Island house off the market.
I'll call him at once and set him straight.
You may have a hard time finding him, Nancy remarked. He says he's on vacation, and no one answers the doorbell at his house. However, I've seen him several times. Mr. Scarlet even chased me in his car while I was on my way to the airport to meet my father. He demanded that I return the key which he had lent me.
You have the key? Mr. Webster asked.
In that case, you keep it and go into the house as often as you please. Nancy told him about her experiences at the moss-covered mansion.
Didn't the wild animals bother you? She asked.
No. In fact, I doubt they were there then.
Nancy mentioned the friendship between Fortin and Scarlet. Mr. Webster was amazed.
It certainly sounds as if something phony is going on. I'll give your father a long option on the house, and notify Mr. Scarlet he no longer has it on his list.
That's very generous of you, said Nancy. My father will be in touch with you.
Mr. Drew and Mr. Billington had gone out again. They did not return until dinner time that evening.
I have nothing new to report, Nancy, her father said. How about you?
Nancy told him of her telephone talk with Mr. Webster. The lawyer was delighted to hear of the long option on the Webster house.
I know that if the mystery of the moss-covered mansion can be cleared up, you'd like me to buy the place.
His daughter laughed.
I guess I'd like it anyhow, but I admit we'd certainly have strange neighbors.
Who could be very dangerous, Bess put in.
Suddenly Hannah Gruen said, Oh, I forgot!
All eyes turned in her direction. She went on. There was a personal in today's paper that caught my eye. Using the code words 1, 5, 9, and 13, the message read, Beam ready for action. Each one at the table pondered the words.
What do they mean? George asked.
This message is the hardest one yet.
The others agreed, but no one had an interpretation to offer. After dinner, Nancy sat down in a big chair in the living room and stared straight ahead of her.
Mr. Drew said, That brain of yours is cooking up something. How about telling us what it is?
Nancy told them she had come up with a daring idea to help solve the mystery.
Using the numbered words code, I'll run a personal in Sunday's paper. It will arrange a meeting for the people who are communicating through the personal column.
That's a clever idea, her father said. I wish you luck.
Nancy found a notebook and pencil. She drafted message after message, but was not satisfied with any of the combination of words. The whole sentence must make sense, as well as the code words. Finally, the others said goodnight and went upstairs. An hour later, Nancy heard the Rosardo's car pull into the driveway.
Oh dear, I don't want them to see these papers, she thought, and quickly gathered them up.
When she reached her room, the young detective sat down to continue her work. Just as sleep was overtaking Nancy, a new idea for the wording of the personal came to her.
I have it, she told herself.
End of chapter 14.